The property market is going to crash by 30 to 50%. The foreclosures are coming. Get out now while you still can. Just kidding. Even though these doomsday predictions sound like complete nonsense now that our property market is soaring higher and higher, these headlines were not so unbelievable just 12 months ago. In fact, these media headlines about a property crash were pretty much the only thing we saw on the news 12 months ago, with all the banks predicting doom and gloom. And a lot of YouTubers getting famous by prophesizing a total market collapse. But as we take a look at what has happened in 2021 so far, they couldn't have been more wrong. And those who had the courage to buy a property during those chaotic times back in 2020 were rewarded with extraordinary amounts of capital growth. However, just because we are currently in a major property boom, it is very important to plan ahead and be forethinking. In today's video, we are going to take a look at the latest housing data, as well as the possibility of an earlier than expected interest rate hike. Just how likely are we to see an interest rate hike before 2024? As well as what an interest rate rise will mean to the market, both in terms of borrowing capacity and market sentiment. As always, I am not a financial advisor and this is not financial advice. I'm simply sharing with you my personal strategies and opinions. I will strongly encourage you to do your own research and due diligence and seek the help of real financial experts before jumping into any big investing or financial decisions. Let's get straight into the video and look at the housing data for May, which was once again very impressive. As we can see here, in the month-on-month change in National Dwelling Value Index, the Australian property market as a whole has risen by 2.2% in the month of May, adding another $14,000 to the national median value. Now, breaking this data down and looking at it in a bit more detail, Hobart was the best performing market in May, with an increase of 3.2%, adding more than $18,000 to the median house price, while Sydney recorded a growth of 3%, which is absolutely insane, considering how much growth we have already seen since the start of 2021. Zooming out and looking at the 3 months change in dwelling values, Sydney, Darwin, Hobart, regional New South Wales, and regional Tasmania were the strongest performers. Even with the other capital cities recording lower rates of growth, they are still on track for strong double-digit growth in 2021. Zooming out even further and looking at the performance of our markets over the last 12 months, Darwin was by far the strongest performer, with a growth of more than 20%. This is absolutely unbelievable, because we need to understand, Darwin also has very strong rental returns. This means the total or combined returns for Darwin for the last 12 months is likely to have exceeded 25%. And given the record low interest environment and the very generous government scheme supporting first home buyers and helping them get into the market with only a 5% deposit, a first home buyer who purchased a property in Darwin 12 months ago would have seen an insane return on investment of more than 400% on their 5% deposit. And putting these percentages into numbers, if a first home buyer had purchased a property for $400,000 and put down a 20% deposit, they would have generated $100,000 in equity. Not bad at all. In fact, if you had purchased a property in Hobart, regional New South Wales, and regional Tasmania, you would have seen very similar results. This just goes to show why it is so important to do your own research and due diligence, instead of listening to these so-called experts who get famous by prophesizing doom and gloom. Going back to the housing data, as we can see here in the graph showing number of new listings coming onto the market, with the black line representing 2021, we can see that the supply of new listings is well above previous years. With more and more supply and listings coming onto the market, it should mean the level of competition in our markets should die down in the coming months, right? Well, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news, but this next graph is going to show us why the level of competition might not ease down anytime soon. This graph gives us an indication of sales activity in the market. And as we can see, the number of sales has pretty much skyrocketed since 2020, and it's currently sitting well above the 5-year average. This will make perfect sense because the sales to new listings ratio is still 1.1 to 1. Meaning there are 1.1 sales for each new listing added to the market, indicating all of this new supply that is coming onto the market is being absorbed extremely quickly by this hungry market. Whatever happened to the March cliff that everyone was talking about when JobKeeper and JobSeeker ended? Now, we are definitely in a major property boom, and the conditions are there to support an ongoing property boom. With prices likely to continue rising in the coming months unless we see a drastic change in the market conditions, such as a hike in interest rates. If you have been watching my previous videos, then you will know that I believe a sooner than expected interest rise is going to happen before 2024. And I have been encouraging my viewers to lock in their interest rates for the next 4 to 5 years. The reason for this is the high level of inflation that we are currently experiencing here in Australia and seeing all around the world. Especially in the US, where the CPI rose at an annual rate of 5% in May, which is the highest since August 2028. The inflation target for most countries is around 2 to 3%, and this will keep their economies growing at a healthy and sustainable manner. But as we can see here, the inflation that we are currently seeing in the US is almost double that. In most cases, when inflation starts creeping up like this, which is not even surprising considering the US printed more than 30% of their money supply over the last 18 months. The government and the central bank risk losing control of inflation, and this is where scary terms like hyperinflation come in. And as we have seen in countries like Germany or Venezuela, hyperinflation pretty much destroys the local economy and the currency. To avoid this, central banks usually start lifting interest rates before this inflation gets too out of hand. So what does all of this have to do with the Australian economy and the Australian property market? Well, we are very similar to the US, more so than you think. And our markets and our economy tends to follow the US economy and the US markets very closely. When the US stock market took a hit back in 2008 and 2020, so did ours. And if the Federal Reserve decide to increase interest rates, it is very likely that our governments will start thinking about increasing our interest rates too, especially with our economy, our jobs markets, our consumer confidence and sentiment all recovering a lot faster than our governments have predicted. Combined with the insane level of growth we are seeing in our property markets, it will only encourage the government to increase interest rates sooner than we expect. If you don't want to listen to me, that's fine. This is what the analysts at ANZ have to say. According to this article by Business Insider Australia, the economics team at ANZ expects the Australian economy to grow by 5% this year and 3.5% in 2022, with unemployment to fall to just 4.4% by the end of next year. Despite the closure of our borders being very tough on our accommodations and tourism industries, it has been very favorable to our labor market because it generated a shortage of workers in a lot of industries, which in turn has generated some much needed wage growth and helping everyday Australians keep up with the increasing cost of living. According to this article, the tighter labor market have generated wage growth and will ultimately push inflation higher. We expect annual growth in the wage price index to accelerate to 3% in the second half of 2022 and hold a bit above 3% through 2023, even as the opening of our borders boost the supply of labor. Based on the performance of our labor market and our economy so far, and this strong forecast, the government and the central banks are well on way to achieving its mandate of 2% inflation and 3% wage growth. This is a lot of information, so let's take a step back and explain what all of this means. Inflation, especially high inflation, is not a good thing. And with the government on track to achieving its GDP and employment goals, it would suggest that the government and the Reserve Bank will start lifting interest rates to keep inflation under control. With these targets likely to be met in the first half of 2023, it could suggest that the government and the Reserve Bank of Australia could start lifting interest rates in the second half of 2023, not too long before their original timeline of increasing interest rates in 2024. We have been talking about an earlier than expected interest rise on this channel for a long time now, and I've shared before in my previous videos how to prepare effectively, such as fixing my loans for the next 3 to 5 years, only focusing on properties with strong rental growth and strong rental income, as well as staying away from Melbourne and Sydney, which are our most heavily leveraged markets. Let's now talk about what is likely to happen when we see higher interest rates. Would it put an end to our property boom? In my personal opinion, when we see higher interest rates, it does not necessarily mean the end of our property boom. But those who have overstretched themselves too much in our competitive markets will definitely face increased financial pressures. This will be more prominent in Melbourne and Sydney due to the higher prices, the lower rental returns, the higher vacancy rates due to the high levels of supply. But it is not all bad news. There are some good news, which is wage growth and the reopening of our borders. If the government achieves the mandate of 3% wage growth, it will put a lot of money into the pockets of everyday Australians, therefore helping homeowners with their repayments. Furthermore, when our borders finally open, we should see more people coming into Australia, which puts more pressure and demand on the housing market, which is likely to increase rent. And this rent growth will help investors with their higher repayments. Another thing to consider is the Australian government's love affair with property, which have been mentioned many times on this channel, and how much the Australian property market means to the Australian economy. With $8.1 trillion worth of household wealth tied up in Australian real estate, as well as the construction industry and the finance industry making up almost 20% of our total GDP, meaning it is not in the government's best interest to put homeowners under too much financial stress, because if the property market crashes, so will the Australian economy, and the flow-on effect will be very devastating and undo all the hard work our governments have done over the last 2 years. So you could definitely be argued that our governments will not risk seeing a correction in our property market and our economy, and therefore they won't lift interest rates until at least 2024. Whether you think we will see higher interest rates in 2013 or not, it is very important to note that our major banks have already started increasing their interest rates. Last month, Australia's biggest bank, the Commonwealth Bank of Australia, increased their 3- and 4-year fixed rates by 0.05%. ANZ also increased their 2-year fixed rate for owner-occupiers by 10 basis points. With two of our biggest banks increasing their medium-term fixed rates, our other banks are likely to follow suit, meaning we will see higher repayments whether the RBA increases the cash rate or not. I think it is very important to understand that 2020 was a very different year, and our governments and our central banks had to put out every tool in their toolbox to keep our economies and our markets afloat. This included dropping our interest rates to pretty much zero. However, we need to understand that whether it is in 2, 3, 4, or 5 years' time, we will see higher interest rates. It is only a matter of time. So we need to be aware and prepare ourselves and set up our portfolios in a way that protects us from higher interest rates and repayments. The next question now becomes, when we do see higher interest rates, whether it's in 2, 3, 4, or 5 years' time, what will happen to the market? Will it crash the housing market and cause a wave of foreclosures? Will it change the market sentiment? The answer to this question is I do not know. And anyone that tells you they know for sure what's going to happen in the next 4, 5, or 6 years is a liar. However, we can always look back in history to see what happened after similar economic shocks when the government started increasing interest rates. Let's take a look at the 2008 global financial crisis. When the GFC hit, the government and the Reserve Bank of Australia responded very quickly by dropping interest rates. This combined with the government's stimulus programs such as the first home buyer grants were able to lift house prices in Australia in a time of uncertainty. If we think about it, this is very similar to what happened in 2022. However, when the Reserve Bank of Australia started lifting interest rates in 2009, house prices continued to increase, and this upward correlation continued until early 2011. This shows that even when interest rates do rise, it does not necessarily mean the housing market is going to slow down. In my personal opinion, the reason why we didn't see a drop in house prices when the interest rates went up was because we had wage growth, and the extra wages the Australians were getting from their jobs were able to service these higher interest rates. With the government predicting strong wage growth in the coming years, it could suggest that we could see a very similar scenario play out over the next 4 to 6 years. Another great example would be the period after 1988. This was when we saw similar levels of price growth in our property markets. The crazy thing about this period was the insanely high interest rates, which peaked at 70% in June 1989. What's even more crazy was that prices continued to increase despite the insanely high interest rates. However, the growth definitely slowed down as we headed into the 90s recession, the recession that we had to have. And this was when the government started dropping interest rates very aggressively. But once again, there were no major corrections in the markets, and most markets simply went sideways for a number of years. Brisbane and Darwin even saw pretty significant price growth during this period. So to answer our question, what will happen to our property market when we see higher interest rates? Well, I do not know, but based on what history is telling us, the last two economic shocks had little to no effect on the housing market. Obviously, history doesn't always repeat itself, and past performance does not guarantee future returns. So in my personal opinion, it is always better to prepare for a correction so that if it happens, we are prepared and we won't be affected too much by it. Another important thing to note here is that our interest rates are already at 0.1%. And if we were to face another economic shock, the government and the Reserve Bank of Australia will have no room to move interest rates further. This is just something to think about if you are thinking about taking on too much debt. And I will strongly encourage you to never, ever take on more debt than you can handle. Alright guys, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do me a huge favor by hitting the like button right there, commenting your thoughts, and subscribing to the channel for more content just like this. And I'll see all of you guys in the next video.